Good to see you as well. And then, welcome the director of Deadpool. Writers and executive producers of the film, Mr. Rhett Reiss and Paul Wernick. And then, lastly, we have the man who's actually been in more Marvel movies than anyone else, and probably one of the most influential people in comics and best looking, Mr. Stan Lee. The questions that you wrote down we'll be answering after the film. We'll be doing a Q&A with all these lovely people. But we're gonna get into seeing some exclusive scenes from the movie. But before we start, I think the director would like to
set.
So it's kind of exciting, but you guys thought you were gonna see some scenes and some footage, but actually you're gonna see the entire movie.
Get right into the Q&A, if that's all right. And the first question is actually for you, Stan.
Uh-oh.
So I'll read it and I'll give you the mic.
Make it easy.
This is actually a fan question. And it's from, if this is your Twitter handle, just like shake your hand in the air. Wakeham10. Is there a Wakeham10? Look at that. Everyone look at Wakeham10. What a good looking man. And he asks, you've been in pretty much every Marvel movie. What cameo has been your favorite?
This one! Yeah! I'm not so dumb.
He knows what that is. Okay, we'll do one more fan question, then we'll get into some of mine, because I'm self-centered, then we'll get back into yours. Alright, this comes from PJ_Campbell. There you are, sir. Look at that. And you're tweeting still. You can't put it down. Alright. What ended up being the hardest part of bringing Deadpool to live action within the already established X-Men universe? So this is for anyone that wants to answer.
Yeah. I'll take it, since I had the most shit from the studio about that very subject. I think it's just the tone. You know, you have these big franchise films that have this very, very serious tone, and then you have Deadpool, and how do you not contaminate the rest of the films with our special brand of humor mixed with fourth wall breaking, mixed with lack of respect for the rest of the genre. So I think balancing in a way that didn't make Fox's skin crawl too much was quite a task. Yeah, and actually, Simon Kinberg down there, the producer. Who really, really had the task of making the studio feel comfortable with the kind of crazy shit
Well, they wanted to do something different, which we did, and we had the comic. So the tone of the comic is the thing we were trying to capture in the movie. And the books do all of that. They should talk to X-Men. They break the fourth wall. You know, we had a lot of debates back and forth, like, can we talk about McAvoy versus Stewart? Can we, reference the fact that there's only two X-Men in the movie? And we ended up going for it, and you guys seem to like it, so.
But I gotta say, with the risk of sounding like a total whore, normally you would expect the studio to be very afraid of this, but right from the get-go, whatever fear they had, they left behind maybe 5 years ago when they didn't let us make this movie, and were very supportive and sort of embraced the whole shit-slinging, foul talk, sex, and stuff.
Yeah, I was going to say, you forgot bra, torture, cancer, death, ultra-violence.
So it's a family film.
Yeah,
what you're saying. So then actually, kind of with that and with the studio, this movie's been in some form of development since 2004. What was that 12-year process like?
I'll let the writers take that one, since they were here for the duration.
Well, it was pretty grueling. You know, my brother the other day was like, oh, I can't, it's coming out so soon. And I was like, it's been 6.5 years. I wouldn't call it soon, necessarily. But it was a long process, you know. We went through various iterations of the script, and it was really thanks to this particular regime, Jim Giannopoulos and Stacey Snyder and Emma Watts and Simon, who finally let us, who trusted us enough to go do this madness. And but it was grueling. There were moments where we thought we, you know, were just as far away from it as could be. We really thought it was dead. Tim is a total pit bull, and he just wouldn't let it die. Nor would Paul, and nor would Ryan. And I think it was that perseverance combined with your perseverance. And when I say that, every time we did have something leak onto the internet, or we did tweet, hey, you know, tweet in support if you want to see the movie, you fans just jumped at it, and that meant a lot. I think the studio paid very close attention to that, so thank you very much. It really is, you're our, you know, 12th man, or whatever they call it, so thank you.
Yeah, good work, you guys! Yeah, you do! And then, so Stan, with that in mind, too, what was it like for you to finally see this movie be made?
I'll show you why I'm a good interviewee. It's nice.
That's going to be on the poster. It's nice, Stanley. I like that. And then for you, Rob, I mean, we've seen this, obviously, this character comic books and video games in a movie before with his mouth sewn shut. What was it like seeing it this time?
Okay, this is my second time seeing it, and it was even better than the first time. That sounds like something Deadpool will say. But here's the deal. 25 years with the Deadpool, this movie comes out 25 years to the day we publish him at Marvel, and you couldn't get a better gift if you're a Deadpool fan. And I have seen 25 years of stories come and go, and Rhett and Paul will tell you, back in 2009, I freaked out when I read the screenplay, because Deadpool has never, ever been better than he was in that screenplay. And when I saw this movie 6 weeks ago, I was like, how much the script would carry? And what you just saw is the best version of Deadpool I have ever experienced in my life. Ryan, Paul, Rhett, Tim, Simon, the entire team, TJ. I mean, that movie is fantastic. And yeah, I'm supposed to be a homer, right? No, I wouldn't sit up here and take the shots. And like Rhett said, for 7 years drone on Twitter and encourage you guys to not give up the fight if this movie wasn't as great as it is. And it's fantastic.
Awesome to hear. And actually with that, with kind of seeing the transition between the screenplay to the big screen, we have a question from a fan, and if I say your handle wrong, I greatly apologize. Hate Lena. Is that close? Was that? Did I do it right? Kind of, what is it?
H-A-F-E,
I didn't change my Twitter handle. My Twitter handle is boring. My Twitter handle is my name.
Is there an underscore or anything? Or like, is there a number, an underscore, or like an asterisk?
No. Nah. Hate Rob, that's not good.
That's not bad. All right, so I apologize. I'm so sorry for doing it, but your question is very good. Was there any point during either writing or filming in which you said, this is going too far, and pulled the line or scene or some footage? To anyone.
I think it did go far enough.
What would you have liked to see?
More nakedness.
So did any, besides more nudity, did anything, was there anything that hit the cutting room floor that you can tell us about?
Well, there was a bunch of stuff, honestly. There'll be an extended version of that naked Ryan fight in the workshop, which there's a couple more beats of violence there that I liked. But we didn't put that in there. And then I think I mentioned this at Comic-Con, but that bar scene was particularly mean and offensive to a lot of people because TJ and Ryan got together and wrote a version of that scene that we just said, oh my God, this is too fucking... I mean, there were so many people offended, it would have really been... We couldn't do it. It was just mean. And so I said, no, we don't have to do that. But TJ...
I don't totally remember that. We did kind of go back and forth and just got more and more hateful. Ryan's a very, very good improviser, and he's very funny and like one of the sweetest guys. But it was very much Yeah, it just got heavy duty. I mean, there's some stuff, like, you know, it's an origin story, so you can't all be comedy, even though this was funny all the way through. But there was, yeah, there's some riffs that I think you look like a trucker took a shit on your shoulders and then shaped ears onto it. So it's like we're missing some of those things. Yeah.
So, I'm just like, I have a visual
angelic little German laugh. You're like,
I'm just like imagining my head, and I don't know if I'm, it's kind of like I'm creeped out, but I also kind of like it.
Yeah.
And I'm just having this real internal struggle.
It was a little worse than that.
Yeah,
he's being gentle. Yeah.
So Brianna, this was one of your first feature films, and you get to be in the X-Men universe. Was there, when you found out the news, were you just like, fudge yeah?
This is exactly what I was
saying. Yeah, this is exact words and everything.
This is my first film ever.
Oh.
This is my first feature film, so it was all like a new experience.
That's amazing. So I'm going to switch to some more fan questions because we got to start blowing through these. So this is from Ra Wilterberger and Ryan Wilterberger. Who wrote Stanley's cameo for this movie? But I think the real answer is that you were already there. Who wrote your cameo for the movie?
You know, I honestly don't know.
I think the scriptwriter must have put it. I know it wasn't Rob. He wouldn't have given me as big a one. He'd have wanted it himself.
That's right.
Well, you got a cameo as well.
It was Paul Werner.
Did he have a bigger one than me?
No, sir.
No. Not his last name.
No Stan, no Marvel, no Marvel, no Deadpool. Period.
All right.
It was Paul. Paul Werner over here.
Nice shot, Paul.
Yes.
Did you know that you wanted a cameo? How did you decide to have him be the strip club DJ?
Well, it was Deadpool, and we figured, would we never expect to see Stan Lee? Or very much expect to see Stan Lee?
he did spend some time in the script as the bathroom attendant in the strip club, if I remember correctly. Yeah. Oh, and there will be another surprise cameo in that scene that was deleted, back to your other question, in the DVD extras.
Fantastic. And then we have one more question. This one is from Weird Life of V.
No way.
Okay, this is the last one, and it is, what was the best scene to shoot? For everyone.
The scene in the bar. Where I pick up the phone and I'm like, we have a problem. That's my favorite part of the movie.
So what?
Thanks, yeah, I did it.
You know, it proves what a good movie this was. It's almost impossible to think of what the best scene was, because they were all so damn good.
I will say, I think that it was the bar scene, but with Brian and Morena, where, I don't know, just... The chemistry that you... Sorry. You're sexy, but not as sexy as Moran. It was... fuck's sake. But, you know, you hope when you cast two people that their chemistry is going to be real, because there's nothing worse. I can mention a few movies out right now where two people look like they're going to kiss, but they don't want to, and it's really disgusting. But Morena and Ryan, they had some real chemistry. And to see that scene for the first time, I mean... I think we tested all the actresses with that scene, and to see it come to life and done so well, and to see them really connect, it was great. I got choked up.
All right, cool. And that is unfortunately all the time we have, but can we please give another big round of applause?